Request Madam President Ms. J. Anandhavalli, President Women Advocates Association, to welcome the gathering.
Happy evening to all. It gives me a great pleasure to have our speaker, Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, amongst us. He is the founder of National Law School of Indian University, Bangalore. He is the father of 5 years integrated law course. When I extended an invitation to an advocate for the lecture, his immediate reaction on seeing the speaker is that he said, he is the man who made the law college to a fine tune. I should not miss this lecture. Only after the formation of law school, we can very well say that there comes to a demand for the law course. With immense pleasure, on behalf of Women Advocate Association, I welcome you, sir. In spite of his busy schedule, his acceptance to come to our association and for a lecture really shows that our association is a blessed one. I welcome Madam Menon. In spite of her some arthritis problem, when we extend our invitation, she has immediately accepted. Thank you, Madam. I welcome Hon'ble Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan, Administrative Judge, Madurai Bench, for accepting our invitation and to preside over the function. I welcome Hon'ble Justice S.S. Sundar, Hon'ble Mr. Justice C. Saravanan, Hon'ble Mr. Justice R. Subramaniam, Hon'ble Mr. Justice P.D. Adikesulu, Hon'ble Mr. Justice G.R. Swaminathan. This week is going to be, this is the last week for this tenure of judges. Therefore, all the judges are very busy. In spite of their busy schedule, they are very particular. They want to hear the lecture of our speaker, Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon. Therefore, they are all present here. I welcome you all, judges. I welcome the President of MBA, Mr. Ramamurthy, the Secretary, Mr. Venkatesan, our advocates of members of other bar, my esteemed women advocates of this association, the Principal of Law College. When I invited him for the lecture, he said, I should alone not be benefited by the lecture. I want the law students also. If you permit us, we will make available some of the students to hear, because they are all very, they cannot go to other states to hear the speeches of our speaker. Therefore, if you allow us, we will make the some of the students also available in WAA. So we said that that case aim can be accommodated, and the some of the law students are here. Welcome you all. I extend a warm welcome to all of you. Let us have a great evening of this session. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. On behalf of MBA, President Ms. J. Anandhavalli will present a shawl to the chief guest, Mr. Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon. I now request Honorable Justice K.K. Sasidharan to honor the speaker of today, Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, with a memento. Thank you, Your Lordship. I now request Mrs. K.R. Shivashankari, Secretary, Women Advocates Association, to present a shawl to Honorable Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan. Thank you, madam. The alumni of Pondicherry Law College would like to honor the chief guest, Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, with a garland. I request the alumni of Pondicherry Law College. May I now request Honorable Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan to deliver his special address to the gathering.
Padmasri, Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, the living legend in legal education. Mrs. Menon, my esteemed brothers on the bench, Mrs. Anandhavalli, the president of the Women's Educator Association, all my lawyer friends and the students of law. It would be very difficult to speak either before Mr. Menon or after Mr. Menon. We have judges here like Justice Swaminathan, who have gone all along from Madurai to Hyderabad to hear Mr. Menon day for us today. So everybody is waiting to hear. Instead of delivering, we will hear him now. And Dr. Madhava Menon, you must be knowing, previously, as a last resort, we used to go to law college. Everywhere admission will be closed, then we will go to law college. We will say that at least you can join in the law college. That was the concept previously. Now, to get admission in a law college, you should have minimum more than 95 points. This transformation of the law colleges, entire credit goes to Dr. Madhava. And the entire legal system in the country has evolved a revolutionary change after Mr. Menon took over the vice chancellor of the National Law Universities. His ideas on education was welcomed by one and all. Now it is time for Sri Menon to deliver the address. Dr. Menon has also selected a very vibrant subject, constitutional morality and constitutional governance. So we'll all hear Dr. Menon. Let me congratulate the office bearers of this association for taking pains to get Sri Menon. In fact, it was very difficult to get a date. So Mr. Menon was very kind to agree to the suggestion. He has to come from Ernakulam to Trichy, from Trichy to Hon'ble. He has taken pains to come over here. We should thank Dr. Menon also. With these few words, I conclude my address. Thank you.
Thank you, Your Lordship. Without any further ado, we are as eager to listen to the lecture of Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon. But before that, 2018 has been an era of the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court had given monumental decisions covering various territories, and the topic of today, constitutional morality and constitutional governance, has been one of the much discussed word or terminology or phenomenon in the recent Sabarimala issue. So we welcome Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon to share his opinion on constitutional morality and constitutional governance with us.
Honorable Mr. Justice Sasidharan, the president of today's function, Honorable Justices of the Madurai bench of the Madras High Court who are present here, members, president and members of the Women Advocates Association who have invited me for this lecture, distinguished invitees, dear students, ladies and gentlemen, let me begin by thanking Madam Anandhavalli and her colleagues in the Women Advocates Association for this generous invitation and hospitality extended to me and to my wife in this visit. It's always an honor for a law teacher or an academician to talk to lawyers, practicing lawyers, who take legal issues to the court, provide innovative arguments, analyzing the law as to what it should be, and judges who write judgments, which are the material with which we try to teach students and develop our understanding of law and jurisprudence. In other words, lawyers and judges together provide the material, the resources for understanding legal developments in our changing society. In this game, the women lawyers is a recent phenomenon, because I remember when I was a student way back in the law college in 1954, there were hardly two students, women students, in the class. And today you go to any law college, anywhere in the country, the majority of students in the law class are women. And many of them are taking to the profession as well, in spite of whatever difficulties they have to encounter with multiple tasks that they have, particularly after marriage. Therefore, it is a challenge that the women face in the legal profession in a highly competitive environment. And many of them are now becoming judges as well. I would imagine 10-15 years later, what would be the state of the profession with a women-dominated bar and perhaps a women-dominated bench. Certainly there will be difference, no doubt about it. But whether it is for the good or bad, time alone will decide. Time alone will decide. Anyway, my congratulations to you, the President, the Secretary and Office Bearers of the Women's Association, as change makers in our legal scenario. You have a big role to play, and I hope you will keep the traditions of the bar in mind when you make the changes at different levels. Honorable Justice Sasidharan is known to me for several years, or decades I should say. We met recently in the Pondicherry Law College, where he also extended an invitation to me and told me that if I bring my wife also, he would organize some visits to some temples in the neighboring area. Ever since we completed our Shashtyabdapurti, we have been on spiritual pursuits, which is partly what our Hindu philosophy envisages, that you either go to Vanaprastha or seek salvation in some spiritual pursuits. I am in that category now. As a joke, I always repeat what Ram Jethmalani told me, that, well, Menon, when you are after 85 and if you are still able to be active, please keep in mind that you are like a person who has taken the boarding pass and waiting at the departure lounge for the announcement to come and the call to come. So I am in that category now. But visiting some of the temples, particularly very ancient temples, which kept the Indian civilization alive and kicking, particularly in Tamil Nadu, remarkable. We have no time to reflect on what our civilization has contributed to human civilization all over the world, of which we must be proud of. Only when foreigners appreciate it, we realize how big our traditions have been. Ladies and gentlemen, when Madam Anandhavalli asked me what is the topic on which you are going to speak, I had no idea as to what would be of interest to you, and certainly it should be a legal topic. But a couple of days before that, I have been reading a speech delivered by our Attorney General K.K. Venugopal, the Dada Chanji Memorial Lecture, in which he questioned the Supreme Court on using constitutional morality as a test for striking down legislation and governmental action, without making clear as to what the content and scope of this concept called constitutional morality. Nobody disputes that there is a concept like this, which is an essential thing in every constitutional culture, more importantly in our scheme of the Constitution. But if there is no clarity in its application, it will naturally vary from judge to judge and provide arguments which may perhaps strike down legislations in a democracy if that is adopted on the basis of individual judges, there are dangers involved, which was the concern of Mr. Attorney General. I therefore suggested to her that I will speak on that subject with special reference to the use by the Supreme Court judges, four of them, invoking constitutional morality, the overarching principle, but interpreting it differently to come to opposite conclusions. And that I could read in the Sabarimala judgment. So I told her that if you permit me to reflect on these aspects, I would be happy, so that I will agitate my mind on this. It is almost as important as the basic structure doctrine given as early as 1973, which changed the constitutional adjudication processes in a very substantive and procedural way. Constitutional morality promises to be another important milestone if it is going to be adopted by the court in a more consistent and analytical way. Friends, before I analyze the use of this concept by the Supreme Court in the Sabarimala judgment, I would like to place before you two or three sets of questions which bother me as to how it is going to impact on future constitutional litigation. So the questions first, up front. One, is constitutional morality an overarching principle, an attitude of mind to be cultivated by all Indian citizens, including the legal community, in a constitutional democracy, as it was envisaged by Dr. Ambedkar? Or is constitutional morality an interpretational tool which the writ courts can invoke when they find no other appropriate test while exercising the power of judicial review? That you want to reach a certain conclusion, all available tests of determining constitutionality are not appropriate to support your conclusion, invoke constitutional morality. If it is yet another test for striking down legislation or governmental action, what are the parameters on which it can be legitimately used, and how objective and robust can those parameters be? Or can it be left to individual judges of the writ courts, High Court and Supreme Court, to decide when and where constitutional morality can be invoked as a tool of judicial review of legislation, and decide when a governmental action is violative of constitutional morality? Quite uncertain, very ambiguous, amorphous situation. Can that be done? After all, a legislation in a democracy is the considered wisdom of we, the people of India, adopted by our representatives in parliament and legislature, and we are the sovereign, and our wishes are reflected by our representatives. If you strike down on the whims and fancies of a judge where we cannot legitimately root it on any constitutional principle, then future of democracy is in peril. That was the concern of Mr. Venugopal. My second set of questions, which after reading the Sabarimala judgment, is a follow-up of the first set of questions. If the express words in the Constitution, express words in the text of the Constitution, convey the intention of the Constitution makers very clearly, is there any scope still the court can disregard that text and invoke constitutional morality to sidestep the express words and bring in some new meaning which the judge thinks appropriate? It did happen in the matter of judicial appointments, as you know. The collegium concept is contrary to the very text of the Constitution. But under certain circumstances it was adopted, and many of us thought that is better that it has been taken over by the judiciary. We have seen the ills of that system as well. There is no system that way perfect. It depends, as Ambedkar said, the men and the women who work the constitution, whether the constitution will serve the good of the country. So this is a serious worry, that if constitutional morality is such an overarching principle, where every governmental action, legislative action, even judicial action should conform with, and if that is the case, the express words which carry a definite intention of the constitution makers, can it be sidestepped, disregarded? This is another question. If so, how can there be certainty in law? That is where I framed the topic, constitutional law versus constitutional morality. A vital factor of certainty of law. Therefore, that is my second question, where I see a conflict between law and morality being taken by constitutional adjudication. My third set of questions, the last set of questions, relate to the approach the constitutional courts are expected to follow when two fundamental rights in Part 3 of the Constitution conflict with each other. It's not unusual. It has happened before also. What should be the judicial approach when fundamental rights conflict, as it happened in the Sabarimala judgment, the religious freedom guaranteed under Article 25 and 26, conflicting with the right to equality under Article 14. The court seemed to have thought on the basis of constitutional morality that Article 14 should prevail over Article 25 and 26. Is that the correct approach? Who decides? Does the Constitution prioritize fundamental rights, that one right is superior to the other? This is a question which needs to be debated in the context of the way in which this principle has been invoked by the Constitution. So my three sets of questions, on which I don't have any definite answers, but I would like to substantiate the concern which the Attorney General expressed in the Dadajanji lecture, and try to suggest to you that if we do not articulate the content, scope, application of this principle, we are inviting trouble in a vital sphere which concerns the future of constitutionalism and democracy, rule of law, all those nice things of a constitutional system. There are many more questions which are thrown up the judgment, but I would like to concentrate the above three sets of questions. My presentation will therefore be in three parts. First of all, I will like to convey to you how the concept of constitutional morality got into constitutional discourse from the beginning. Dr. Ambedkar himself used the word in the drafting committee and in the Constituent Assembly. This is to find some common agreement on what this concept means in terms of constitutional decision making. Because Ambedkar is the right person whose explanation we will have to accept if you want to know the intention of the constitution makers while using the concept of constitutional morality. So I'll try to briefly refer to Dr. Ambedkar. My second part of the presentation will be taking you through a series of judicial decisions. There are a dozen of them from the Supreme Court itself, where references to constitutional morality have been taken. And courts have used it not necessarily as a test for striking down legislation, but to support the reasoning given by the judges for a particular decision. So I'd like to highlight how the Supreme Court has taken, in fact, a 360 degree change from their earlier position. They have taken this 360 degree change in many cases. But here is one situation where it has happened. And finally, I will take you to look at the way four judges of the Supreme Court, sitting judges of the Supreme Court, have used the constitutional morality for contradictory conclusions in the Sabarimala judgment, which makes us think as to what the future holds out for us. So if those three parts, I will do it in the next 20-25 minutes. These are profound concepts which requires understanding of history, understanding of political science, understanding of society, a whole lot of things, because constitution is not yet another legislation which you can interpret according to Maxwell's rules of interpretation. Constitution is a living thing, is a growing thing. It gives unity and future for the future of this 1.3 billion strong democracy, the largest in the world. Therefore, the constitution is what holds us together. Tamilians, Malayalis, Assamis, Bengalis, diverse culture, diverse religion, diverse language, diverse food habits. What makes us an Indian? It is of Indian constitution. Otherwise, there is no difference between us and the Bangladeshis or the Pakistanis. Same culture. So this diversity of cultures, this civilization which has the capacity to absorb diversity and give us a hybrid which can hold the diverse world together. And if democracy could succeed in this country, it is a model for the rest of the world. All these other countries in Europe and America, what is the diversity there? They speak English. They subscribe to Christianity. They have the same style of food habits. Only migrants, when they come, they have some diversity. Whereas in our country, it is not. It is a living reality. You see it every day, right and left. And same rule of law, same constitutional philosophy, which holds certain values which are inherent in Indian civilization. This must continue, otherwise our country will disintegrate, like Yugoslavia or any other country. There is no question of rewriting the constitution. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, when constitutional issues are discussed, particularly the younger generation, and more particularly the women in the legal field, must agitate your mind, assess it in the context of history, in the context of our own civilization, and make a determined bid to question it and validate it and legitimize it and make it understandable to the newer generation, who are all people born after India won its freedom. For them, there is no understanding as to what we suffered during colonial rule and how we survived and what was the result of all those things. Be that as it may, how did Dr. Ambedkar bring this concept into the constitutional discourse? This is what he, from a socio-cultural perspective, how do you define morality? It can mean different things to different people. Though law has to correspond with public morality in order to achieve legitimacy and social acceptance, in modern times, law is much ahead of morality, and the two interact in different ways to influence social attitudes and behavior. Even when a written constitution like ours, incorporating individual rights, was adopted, reasonable restrictions have been put on those rights on the basis of principles of public morality. Because if the gulf between the living law and the aspirational law, the constitution, is so wide, then nobody will care for it and it will break. It will not get the legitimacy, the respect. So the law has to be interpreted in relation to the living facts and situations of life. And the role of the lawyers and judges is to bring it together through an interpretational logic that will be acceptable to the current members of society. Then life will be much happier. Otherwise, you will have, living relationship is legitimized now. So what? Many people are apprehensive. Supreme Court has decided it on the basis of some principle, maybe on constitutional morality. But what will be the implication of it? Does it mean that people can marry within the same sex? Marriage is no more an institution to be sacrosanct in our context. Family can disintegrate, or family means two men living together or two women living together. What about the succession, the fate of children? Adultery is permitted. So what? You know, we have all celebrated by these judgments. But I don't think that even triple talaq, even when it is made illegal, it goes on in society. Dowry goes on in society. Fortunately, untouchability is not prevalent to that extent, though Justice Chandrajud seemed to think in the Sabarimala judgment that untouchability is, look at the way the judges look at it. Restricting women of certain age group from entering into Sabarimala, can it be related to untouchability? I can't, by any stretch of imagination. Untouchability has a social context. This is not reasonable. Restrictions cannot be untouchability. That means, can you think, a man and woman shall not be too intimately sitting together in a public place who do not know each other? Is it because of untouchability? Are we, people who have certain type of contagious diseases are kept away from others? Is it untouchability? So there are questions which, because judges do not have their pulse in Indian traditions, Indian practices, however rude it be. But of course, it is offensive to basic individual rights, it is to go. That is how untouchability has gone. Well, in which other constitution a crime is made by the constitution? It's the Indian constitution which declared that untouchability and whatever practices related to that shall be deemed to be criminal and will be appropriately punished. So therefore, certain things are to be prohibited because it is inconsistent with accepted mode of today's public morality. But if you interpret that public morality, thus morality is not alien to constitutional interpretation. Article 25, 26, Article 26 does include public morality, order, public order and public health as grounds on which you can restrict freedom of religion. In a forthright speech in the draft constitution, Dr. Ambedkar said, and look at this beauty of this, he said, and I quote, "Constitutional morality is not a natural sentiment of the people of India. We have not been democratic at all. Inequality was widely prevalent. And British did not allow us to behave in a democratic way. The democratic institutions have not developed in our society for a variety of reasons. Now suddenly we got independence and we adopted democracy." Ambedkar said, while giving the constitution draft, he said, look, democracy can survive only on the basis of certain accepted norms. Constitutional morality is not, unfortunately, a natural sentiment of Indian people. It has to be cultivated for the success of democracy. We must realize that our people have yet to learn constitutional morality. Democracy in India is only a top dressing on an Indian soil which is essentially undemocratic. Quotation close. What does it mean? He meant that if you want rule of law, democracy and constitutionalism to develop in this undemocratic society, you have to diffuse this concept of constitutionalism and the morality involved in public relations to every section of Indian society, cutting across this caste, religious, other divides. This may take time, but the quicker it is, the better for Indian democracy, because constitutional morality is a sentiment of the people, both the citizens as well as the rulers, the elected people. So therefore, constitutional governance, a constitutional culture or constitutionalism on the part of the citizenry and those who operate the constitutional institution, Dr. Ambedkar argued, is a precondition for success of democracy and rule of law. Unfortunately, he felt that sentiment is not natural with the people in India and it has to be cultivated for democracy to take roots on Indian soil. This is perfectly understandable to us, those who know the Indian society and the way the social hierarchy and the divisions that we had through the caste system. It will be ingenious from this premise of Dr. Ambedkar's idea of constitutional morality as a sentiment of the people, from that premise it will be ingenious to argue that Ambedkar wanted the court to use this concept as a tool for judicial review of legislation and executive action, a result which the Supreme Court nearly brought about through the Sabarimala judgment. No doubt constitutional morality is embedded in the idea of constitutionalism, constitutional culture, which restricts state action with a view to prevent arbitrariness or majoritarianism and protection of individual rights. Constitutional morality is supposed to inform all constitutional institutions, including the judiciary, and act as a moral restraint beyond the legal order on their functioning. In this sense, I submit to you, it's only an attitude of mind respectful of rule of law and complementarity of constitutional institutions. I would like to emphasize this, though, you know, many people misunderstand me when I explain. In my understanding of the constitutional scheme, the judiciary, the executive, the legislature, these are co-equal in the functioning of our constitutional governance. None is superior to the other. Of course, their functions are different. Merely because that you have the power to strike down legislation or governmental action on the test of constitutionality, we won't say that the Supreme Court is superior to Parliament. That is absurd in a democracy. The democracy, there is a superior or the sovereign, or can only be the people. We the people of India. And to the extent that 1.3 billion people cannot claim and deliberate, we have a representative system. So technically speaking, if you believe in democracy, if you believe in the faith of the people of India, then you have to put that superiority on the legislature rather than the judiciary. Because under that logic, one may even argue, after all, the judges are appointed by the executive, therefore the executive is superior over judges. Or you can argue that a parliament can impeach the judges, therefore the legislature is superior to the judiciary, Supreme Court. That is not. They have assigned functions to make a written constitution work. Therefore, judiciary is only co-equal to the other two institutions with no claim for superiority. They can't say that the parliament did not know constitutional morality, only the judges knew that. These are strong words, which in the presence of judges, I shudder to think. I will not cross the Lakshman Rekha, lest a contempt is issued against me. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, it will be interesting to examine whether constitutional morality would allow. Now, this is an academic question that I have raised. Does constitutional morality allow civil disobedience, which Gandhiji propagated during colonial rule? Does constitutional morality allow a violent revolution? Does constitutional morality allow continuous hartal, disobedience to rule of law? Can the courts do anything about it? You can declare the hartal, as Kerala High Court did, as unconstitutional. But it goes on day and day by some other name, if you like. And some courts have interpreted it as right to dissent. Yes, right to dissent is vital in democracy. But everything is on certain parameters, certain boundaries. Otherwise, systems will not work. Mere judicial orders and diktats will not make a democracy so huge and diverse like ours really deliver. You can keep on fighting. You can keep on looking every executive act in suspicion. You can always see that, look, parliament is always on fight and they don't devote adequate time, so legislation has to be. This is against the principle. In fact, the principle in constitutional interpretation is prima facie, a legislation is constitutional. And it is, the burden is on those who challenge its constitutionality, not on the government. Okay, therefore that is the idea which originally the discourse which Ambedkar initiated in the Constituent Assembly about constitutional morality, with a limited application of a culture to be cultivated among the people and its rulers over a period of time, an attitude of mind towards larger principles of civilized discourse, of fairness in society. To that extent, nobody can dispute that this is a vital principle of constitutional jurisprudence. My second part of my presentation, as I told you, is about how the Supreme Court has used this concept over a period of time. And it's very interesting. You know, the first important constitutional case decided by our Supreme Court was A.K. Gopalan versus Union of India. And in that case, the judges of the Supreme Court unanimously have adopted what is the relative status of legislature and judiciary in the matter of constitutional governance. And what did they say? I quote from A.K. Gopalan judgment: where the constitution has not limited, either in terms of or by necessary implication, the general powers conferred upon the legislature, parliament, we cannot declare a limitation under the notion of having discovered something in the spirit of the constitution, which is not even mentioned in the instrument, the constitutional text. They say that if the express words of the constitution do not limit the power of the legislature, we cannot import some funny idea to limit the powers which are not there in the text of the constitution. What a large leeway the Supreme Court was willing to give to the parliament to develop constitutional governance, which is not even mentioned in the instrument. It is difficult upon any general principles to limit the omnipotence of the sovereign legislative power by judicial interposition, except so far as the express words of a written constitution give that authority to this court. That was a position of 1950. This initial approach of not seeking authority not assigned by the written text was abandoned by the court when, in Keshavananda Bharati versus State of Kerala, 1973, it brought in the basic structure theory from outside the written text in limiting Parliament's power to amend the constitution. Since then, there was no looking back in expanding the power of the court, which it justified on the spirit of the constitution. The court has slightly changed its approach to constitutional interpretation and bringing in principles from outside the constitutional text ever since AK Gopalan case. And an interesting case that was decided in 2003, the Islamic Academy versus State of Karnataka, the court held that an affirmative action, even if constitutionally valid, cannot ignore constitutional morality, which embraces in itself the doctrine of equality. So affirmative action, including reservation, is provided for in the constitutional text, amended or original. But its limitations cannot be by invoking, cannot ignore constitutional morality. Now, if you read the total judgment of the Islamic Academy, you will get the idea of how they have tried to harmonious construction between the affirmative action and its limitations. For example, the 50% outer limit, which does not apply to Tamil Nadu, is a different matter. But later judgment is very interesting in the National Judicial Appointment Commission case. The observation of Chief Justice Kerr is very significant to denote that the court was not willing to abandon the constitutional text in reviewing legislative action. The constitutional text was given due importance, not to be disregarded by invoking like constitutional morality, basic structure and things like that. And Justice Kerr in that case has, and I quote Chief Justice Kerr, that this court, while carving out each of the above basic features, that constitutional morality was not an issue in the Judicial Appointment Commission case, but basic structure was an issue on which it decided to strike down that act. This court, while carving out each of the above basic features, placed reliance on one or more articles of the Constitution. It goes without saying that for carving out each of those core basic features, only the provisions of the Constitution are relied upon. It is therefore apparent that the determination of the basic feature is made exclusively from the provisions of the Constitution, the text of the Constitution. So constitutional morality can be yet another supportive if you reason the judgment on the text and you have a conclusion which requires further strengthening, okay, you use constitutional morality also. But you cannot invoke constitutional morality contrary to the text of the Constitution. That was Chief Justice Kerr in the National Judicial Appointment case. Finally, a couple of judgments of 2018 from Chief Justice Deepak Mishra, very relevant because he was having a different idea about constitutional morality. And one of it is the National Capital Territory of Delhi versus the Union of India, 2018 8SCC 501. The court held that constitutional morality acts as a check on the lapses of the government and colorable activities aimed at affecting the democratic nature of the polity. It has to be checked. If you exercise power through colorable exercise of your power, assigned power, then we will invoke constitutional morality to check your action. But tell us, my Lord, what is constitutional morality? That is where there is a gap. The adoption of constitutional morality as a supreme standard of testing constitutionality of governmental action and legislation was declared very clearly in the Indian Young Lawyers Forum versus State of Kerala, popularly known as the Sabarimala judgment. And there, Justice Deepak Mishra, who crafted the earlier judgment in Navdej Singh Johar versus Union of India, again a 2018 judgment. That was where Justice Deepak Mishra has given clarity to his own understanding of constitutional morality in constitutional adjudication. And what did he say? This was supported by Justice Kanvilkar also. He declared, the concept of constitutional morality is not limited to mere observance of the core principles of constitutionalism. Don't try to limit the scope of constitutional morality either to the express words or its core principles. But, he says, the magnitude and sweep of constitutional morality is not confined to the provisions of the literal text of the Constitution. Rather, it embraces within itself virtues of a wide magnitude, such as that of ushering in a pluralistic and inclusive society while at the same time adhering to other principles of constitutionalism. What did you get out of this? He says, look, constitutional morality cannot be captured in few words in the text of the Constitution. It has a much wider, okay, we agree that part. But he is trying to justify that even the court can deviate from the text, invoking this wider overarching principle about which only the judge knows what he means. This is where the difficulty arises. It is further the result of embodying constitutional morality that values of constitutionalism can trickle down and percolate through the apparatus of the state for the betterment of each and every individual citizen of the state, unquote. This is a quote from the Sabarimala judgment of Chief Justice Mishra and Justice Kanvilkar. The majority judgment further said that when there is a violation of fundamental rights, the term morality in Article 25.1, 25.2, which allows restriction on fundamental rights, you know that religious freedom can be restricted on grounds of public morality, public health and public order. Now he tries to tell us that public morality in Article 25 Clause 2 is constitutional morality. There is no difference. This is synonymous. That means whatever customs, traditions and morality principles that the public have been following for several decades or years have no validity if it doesn't tally with what he considers as constitutional morality. Very articulate way of, lawyer-like way of expressing things, leaving us in great doubt and uncertainty of such an important constitutional principle on which you are striking down the legislation relating to restrictions on entry to the Sabarimala. Furthermore, the court said, the notions of public order, morality and health cannot be used as colorable device to restrict the freedom to freely practice religion and discriminate against women. By denying them their legal right to enter and offer their prayers at the Sabarimala temple for the simple reason that public morality must yield to constitutional morality. Because public morality can be a ground under which the legislature can restrict religious freedom. The Supreme Court is arguing through Chief Justice Mishra and Kanvilkar that look, public morality in this context is what Constitution thinks about constitutional morality, far removed from Ambedkar's conception in the Constituent Assembly. In the concurring judgment of Justice Chandrachud, things are much worse. Here he says, the draft persons engage with prevailing morality in society or to something more fundamental. And he answered the question by saying, individual dignity cannot be allowed to be subordinate to the majority or to the morality of the mob. He considers the people in India following a certain standard of morality as a morality of the mob. And that is not what a public morality that the Constitution envisaged. And he says, nor can the intolerance of society operate as a marauding morality to control individual self-expression in its manifest form. The Constitution would not render the existence of rights so precarious by subjecting them to passing fancies or to the aberrations of a morality of a popular opinion. On this premise, Justice Chandrachud concluded that morality for the purpose of Article 25 and 26 must mean that which is governed by the fundamental constitutional principles, whatever it would mean. These founding principles must govern our constitutional notions of morality. So I don't know whether you would be able to accept this proposition that public morality, on which legislature can put restrictions on fundamental freedoms, is the same thing as constitutional morality. If you remember the Lady Chatterley's lover judgment of Justice Hidayatullah, where he declared it as violative of public morals, how did the Supreme Court find out that Lady Chatterley's lover contained passages which are violative of the prevailing public morality in India? He had to consult several literary critics who came as witnesses before the Supreme Court and testified that this is much violative, this is morality of the Europeans, whereas public morality as prevailing in the Indian situation, this type of a novel will be obscene. And he had no hesitation on that basis, with some empirical evidence, to find public morality that was prescribed to restrict freedom of speech and expression, more vital than anything else in a democracy. So public morality is different from constitutional morality, whereas both Chief Justice Deepak Mishra and Justice Chandrajud seem to think that they are synonymous when constitutional interpretation comes. And now my last submission is about the Rohinton Nariman, who wrote a concurring judgment, did not dwell on constitutional morality at all. His reasoning was on different grounds of whether religious denomination or whether it is an essential part of religious practice, etc., etc. Now I come to Justice Indu Malhotra, who also invoked constitutional morality and explained her position as to why she would reach or invoke constitutional morality to come to a conclusion just contradictory to Justice Deepak Mishra, Kanvilkar and Chandrachur. And this is what she has to say. According to Justice Indu Malhotra, constitutional morality refers to the moral values underpinning the text of the Constitution, which are instructive in ascertaining the true meaning of the Constitution. You can have these values underlying. This is a human universal values of truth, compassion, fraternity, equality, liberty, right from the French Revolution. It's the whole humanity follows it, because that is part of civilization. That is the underlying principles which we invariably, whether you are in the government or in the legislature or in the judiciary, has to follow if you believe in a constitutional democracy. And that is reflected in the Constitution. If you have any doubt in understanding the text of the Constitution, okay, you go to the underlying value to find it out. But they depend on the text. So she said that and achieve the objects contemplated therein. Constitutional morality in a pluralistic society and in a secular polity would reflect that the followers of various sects have the freedom to practice their faith in accordance with the tenets of their religion. It is irrelevant whether the practice is rational or logical. Very, very clear, outspoken. It is irrelevant that whether the practice that followed as part of their religion, their faith, their belief, which is a fundamental right, is rational or logical. Whether the tenets of their religion, it is irrelevant whether the practice is rational or logical. Notions of rationality cannot be invoked in matters of religion by courts. Now that is the foundation for the review petition to be argued. If you read the written statement filed by Mr. Parashuram, one of the very strongest and articulate, I mean, he's a genius in legal field and a man who knows much more than any one of us has vetted that that affidavit, and you will understand as to how he has depended on this premise of Justice Indu Malhotra. And incidentally, she is a woman who has passed the judgment. So therefore, and you have to have the guts to stand against four of your senior colleagues in the Supreme Court and write a dissenting judgment based on constitutional arguments. That is why women can make changes significantly. That is the equality and non-discrimination, she writes, are certainly one facet of constitutional morality. However, the concept of equality and non-discrimination in matters of religion cannot be viewed in isolation. Under our constitutional scheme, a balance is required to be struck. Why? Because of our diversity and our commitment to secularism. Between the principle of equality and non-discrimination on the one hand and the protection of the cherished liberties of faith, belief and worship guaranteed by Articles 25 and 26 to persons belonging to all religions in a secular polity. On the other hand, constitutional morality therefore requires a harmonization or balancing of all such rights to ensure that the religious beliefs of none are obliterated or undermined. If you were to look into the practice, I remember, you know, when I was in Bangalore in the 1980s and 90s, there was a custom followed by women. Ellamma was a goddess whom they worshipped, and Ellamma's temple up the hill. These women on a particular day used to run from the foothill to the hills almost naked. And it is a custom which was rigorously followed. Many of them fall down, injure, this and that. The trouble came when men started accumulating to see the whole drama. And then public order limitations and all that. And this, what I am saying is, many of our faith and belief cannot be tested on modern rational principles. If you do that, many religions will be obliterated, according to Justice Indu Malhotra. Religion itself will not exist. Tomorrow, some judges may say, worshipping in an idol in a temple is anti-scientific, irrational, violative of the constitutional morality. What do you do? Idol worship is, yes. How do you, it is against scientific temper. So many things can be condemned and ruled out as unconstitutional. And you say that public morality is the same thing as constitutional morality. We are in soup. Those who believe in religion, those who do not believe in religion, like my chief minister in Kerala, they can do anything and get away with it. Well, therefore, it is striking to find the content and meaning and application of constitutional morality so widely vary in the hands of judges of the same constitutional bench. On the facts of the same case, Shabarimala, the judges are able to use the very same concept to both accept and reject the claim of constitutionality, leaving the citizen and the state functionaries to gather the law under the constitution. Several questions, therefore, are open for future lawyers to argue and give some clarity to ordinary citizens like me, so that constitutionalism and constitutional governance and democracy can continue with rule of law if the Supreme Court is inclined to be a little more kind in constitutional adjudication. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your valuable opinions with us. Moving on, Women Advocates Association would like to encourage the students from the law college who have come all the way beyond their college hours to attend this lecture by Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, and the alumni of the Pondicherry Law College, the advocates from Pondicherry Law College practicing at the Madurai bench, would like to honor the students with mementos. May I now request Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon to give the mementos to the students of Law College, Madurai, Government Law College, Madurai. Ms. P. Preeta, 4th year BA LLB. The alumni of Pondicherry Law College is giving away books to the law books to the students of Government Law College for their enthusiasm in attending the lectures conducted by the advocate associations. Ms. P. Preeta, 4th year BA LLB, Government Law College, Madurai. Ms. R. Priya, 4th year BA LLB. Ms. R. Florence Becky Catherine, 4th year BA LLB. Ms. R. Kirtana, 4th year BA LLB. And Ms. V. Sebastianal Preeti, final year BA BL. Thank you, sir. The Women Advocates Association also renders its thanks to the alumni of Pondicherry Law College practicing here. The alumni of the Pondicherry Law College who have donated books to the Women Advocate Association, to the law students, as well as to the Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon Library Section, which was declared open today. May I now request Honorable Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan to honor the donors for today's library section. Mr. K. Samidurai, once again may I request Honorable Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan to honor our donors. Mr. K. Samidurai, Mr. Ayram K. Selvakumar, Mr. Sundar Srinivasan, on behalf of Mr. T. Arul, on behalf of him, Ms. Ramya will receive the memento on behalf of Mr. T. Arul, Mr. Raja Jayachandra Paul. We would also like to honor Dr. Manohar, Principal Government Law College, Madurai, who has rendered his support to the Women Advocates Association. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Your Lordship. As a token of our gratitude to Mrs. Menon, our President, Ms. J. Anandhavalli, will present a gift to Mrs. Menon. Thank you, Madam. I request Mrs. K.R. Shivashankari, Secretary, Women Advocates Association, to deliver the vote of thanks.
Honorable Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan, the companion judges, Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon and Mrs. Menon, the principal of Madurai Law College, Mr. Manoharan, and the professors of Madurai Law College, good evening to all. It is proper if I say as constitution evening. Yes, all our minds are filled with the constitutional thinking. Thankfulness is the beginning of gratitude, and gratitude is the completion of thankfulness. I feel honored and privileged to propose a thank you note on this momentous occasion. To begin with, I thank the Lord Almighty for showering her blessings on us to reach the heights. Thank you, God. I extend my gratitude to the Honorable Mr. Justice K.K. Sasidharan for his presence and for his invaluable guidance for us. Thank you, Judge. I thank the Honorable Judges, Honorable Justice R. Subramanian, Honorable Justice P. D. Adi Kesavalu, Honorable Justice S. S. Sundar, Honorable Justice G. R. Swaminathan, Honorable Justice C. Saravanan for gracing the occasion and making us blissful in this evening, sir. Thank you, judges. I extend my sincere gratitude to Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon, the living legend of law, for visiting WAA and enlightening us with the knowledge, sir. The words of wisdom from you radiated a source of energy within us, sir. The way you explain the topic is exemplary, sir. Thank you for sharing your ideas. Thank you for sharing your ideas and experiences with us, sir. And WA is honored by your presence today, sir. Thank you, sir. I extend my humble gratitude to Mrs. Menon for accepting our invitation to visit the Women Advocate Association, ma'am. And I say that the secret of energy of Padmasri Dr. Madhava Menon is Mrs. Menon. Thank you, ma'am. that we could see in the where the care taken by the Mrs. Menon on his part.
When I met Mrs. Menon at Trivandrum, Mr. Menon was not there. She told me that his initial, that is N.R. Madhava Menon, he is non-resident Madhava Menon. he never stays at Trivandrum. He is always on tour. So he is non-resident Madhava Menon, correct? In fact, out of these 6 judges, 4 are his students, actually. All the, myself, this is Subramanian, this is Saravanan, and this is Swaminathan, and Mr. Swaminathan, Mr. Irish, we are all students of the Pondicherry Law College. Thank you.
Thank you, Judge, for sharing the nostalgic moments, sir. And I extend my special thanks to the principal of Madurai Law College, Mr. Manoharan sir, for giving his consent to send the students of Law College and making your presence to witness the evening occasion, sir. Thank you, sir. And I extend my gratitude from the bottom of my heart to the donors, alumni of Pondicherry Law College, Mr. K. Swaminathan sir, Mr. Iram Silukumar sir, Mr. T. Raja J. Chandrapal, Mr. T. Arul, and Mr. R. Sundar Srinivasan sir, for their generous contribution to the library section in the name of Padmasri Dr. N.R. Madhava Menon. And by each and every donation of yours, the library section of WA is becoming legally stronger. Thank you, donors. And I thank the press and media for supporting WA in all the occasions. And I thank the senior advocates, the president and secretary of MBA, and all my senior and junior advocate friends for your presence in the evening. And I thank the master of ceremony, Ms. Abhinaya, for moving us in the right schedule. And I thank the office bearers of WA, the staff of WA. And I thank you all. No matter what language we speak, a kind and smiling thank you always speaks to everyone's heart. Thank you, one and all.